Learn about the best practices for loading data into Azure SQL this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Denzil Ribeiro, a program manager on the Azure SQL team. Denzil, thanks so much for coming on the show again.
Thank you, Anna. Always awesome. A pleasure.
Yeah, awesome. And it's always a pleasure to have you on. You always have the coolest demos and we always learn so much. And today we're going to be talking about data loading best practices. And I know you have a lot planned. So let's just get right into it. I wanted to start by asking you if you had any like top of mind thoughts about kind of data loading, things we should think about.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, folks who are used to SQL Server on-premise may have simple recovery model and things of that nature. When you're talking about Azure SQL DB, Azure SQL DB is always in full recovery model. And to guarantee our SLA, we do have log generation limits. And the limits are based generally on, you know, the service objective and tier. And in fact, the limits are queryable from a DMV. You have the primary max log rate, which gives you what's the limit for the SQL DB in question or Azure SQL DB in question. Now, all the demos is subsequently I'm doing on the hyperscale tier. In hyperscale, what's unique is the log limit is 100 MB per second, irrespective of the compute size, whether it's 2-core, 4-core, 8-core. But note that you're not going to be able to drive 100 MB per second log generation rate if you use just a 2-core, because the bottleneck will be CPU and won't be log, right? And so when we reach these log limits, we will see a wait type called log rate governor, which shows up in wait types of SQL servers. So since this log generation is a commodity in a way, data compression helps maximize this log generation rate that you can ingest. Other best practices include things like for large tables, if you're talking billion row tables, partition them because maintenance becomes significantly easier. Things like archiving a partition, truncating a partition, rebuilding an index for a partition, so on and so forth. And then choice of, we'll see row store versus column store, but remember that the choice of whether you choose a B-tree or row store or column store is not just based on data loading. It's based on your workload patterns, and if that corresponding row store or column store is right for your workload.
These are some good tips. I know you have some like scenarios kind of to help us walk through, because there's a lot of different things to take into consideration, not necessarily like the fastest loading possible. So it'd be awesome to just hop right into the demo.
Absolutely. So let's look at, I'm going to use Spark for this demo. And though the concepts are pretty relevant to ADF or ADF data flows or other ETL mechanisms, so they're not unique to Spark. It just is easier for me to demo with the options clearly documented here. So the first thing we're going to do is actually load into a heap. So I have a heap where this is a heap. And on a heap, what's unique is you can specify tab lock equal to true to allow multiple parallel threads to load. And here I'm loading actually about 6.5 gigs of data. I'm going to launch this so that, you know, while it's running, we can go through this scenario. And then we have a batch size, commit batch size of 100K rows. Right? So this is launched. It's read the data from the lake, and it's actually running 32 parallel tasks. So while we do this, we will actually look at a couple of things. We'll look at the max log rate. We talked about that DMV. And we'll see that for hyperscale here, it is set to 105 MB per second. If you look at the results here, and that's for the hyperscale tier. Now we are loading into a heap, and you'll see that we have 32 parallel loads going on. And this wait type log rate governor actually indicates that we are hitting that limit, right? So there are two ways to look at it, and we'll look at this from a DMV perspective. The DMV you can look at for log generation rate is this DM resource governor workload group CX. And we can take the delta log bytes that are recorded for a particular duration. And this is just math converting it to MB. And we'll see that, you know, over the last couple minutes, at least, or couple seconds, if you will, we are at 98 megs log generation rate, which is very close to the cap. Again, viewing this from a dashboard perspective, we'll see a couple of things. We see that our CPU is about 40%. And these are perfmon counters charted out by Telegraph and using a Grafana dashboard. But we see these averages of, right about the threshold, it toggles from 95 to 105, MB. So that's the log generation rate on a heap. And if you wait long enough, it should complete in about, 2 minutes. This should be completing, very shortly. So we see that this took 1.9 minutes here, and we'll summarize those results. So that's a heap. But remember that with a heap, you still, before you actually consume the data, you likely are going to create a clustered index or set of indexes, because your queries on a heap otherwise are all going to result in scans, right? Which is not necessarily efficient. So let's look at the second type of index, which is a Columnstore index. This is more used for analytics. Again, I'm going to fire this workload real quick, and then we'll discuss. Parallel loading into Columnstore, actually, you don't want to specify tablock equal to true. Tablock equal to true is only for a heap. It'll serialize. If you do, it'll serialize each thread, and they'll block each other. The other thing is Columnstore data is stored as segments. We want a batch size greater than 102,400, if possible, because then the data is compressed before it's ingested. And the segments themselves actually are compressed before it's written to the log, right? So closer to a million, anything over 102,400 is good from a Columnstore perspective. If we look at log generation rate here, same thing like we did before. We do not see any wait types anymore. You see the wait type is null, though we have 32 bulk inserts running. And looking at the dashboard, we're going to see some different characteristics. I'm going to refresh this dashboard. First is we see on a 16 core, we have more than 16 threads inserting. Our CPU is close to 100%. I think I used a bigger cluster than I did in my prior test from a Spark perspective. But you see, CPU is much higher than before. and then, I have log bytes flushed, which is significantly less than before. So looking at log byte flush, you see peaks and valleys, but it's not consistently right. 95 Mbps, right? Anna, you had a question?
No, I was just saying, okay. Wow, yeah.
Yep. Yeah, so you could, so here CPU is my bottleneck at 16 cores, but I could invariably go to 32 cores or 80 cores and then optimize on this log generation rate, because even at that, I'm not necessarily going to have sustained 100 Mbps, right? So this doesn't mean the time to load is fundamentally going to improve. In fact, the time to load will be a little slower, but it loads into compress row groups. You'll see directly if I look at the Columnstore metadata, which is this row group physical stats, you never see, uncompressed row groups. If you had to use a batch size less than 102,400, this would land in the delta store part, which is a row store part of Columnstore, and would be then compressed by a background thread as those groups fill up to a million rows. But that ingest actually works just like a B-tree or heap where it's not into compressed row groups directly. So you would see a log generation rate closer to 100. So, I could demo that, but for time, I am not going to demo that. I will show the results of what that looks like, from the results perspective. The third scenario we're going to look is that last scenario where you're base data is a B-tree. So it's not a heap, it's not Columnstore, but it's a clustered index. And there are several variations of this. This could be compressed, row compressed, page compressed, or not compressed. So the first thing I'm doing is I'm going to ingest this data. And in this case, I'm not sorting the data or anything of that sort. I am just going to start this. And again, because this is not Columnstore, I'm using 100K batch size, 100,000 rows per batch. And then since it's not a heap, I'm using tablock equal to false. Right? So let's look at some diagnostics from the SQL side here. This is going to take forever because now each thread, there are 32 threads, is inserting conflicting ranges because I've not sorted in the clustered key. And you see a ton of contention on locks, right? So we see a lot of blocking sessions. You see lock wait types, and you see the pages in question. I am actually going to cancel this because this will be waiting for a while otherwise. So what do I do as, if I want to actually save time from ingesting into a heap and building a clustered index? The alternative I can do here is I can sort the data on source, which I've already done, and then ingest it again into the same table. So I have my clustered column store table, let me just make sure. Yep, I do. I am actually going to ingest this data into this, and you'll see this Spark job actually will have multiple phases. The first part is actually each worker that picks up rows is going to sort those rows, and there's a little bit more work on the client side because of the sort that I've specified here before the ingest is actually done. So you'll see a couple jobs here. And this is not actually ingesting yet. So the first parts are actually sorting on the client side. So there's a little more work on the client side, but it's well worth it as we look at the results. And as soon as these two stages are done, the bulk insert will start. This is roughly around 6.5 or 6.8 gigs of data, around 60 million rows. So now we got to the ingest part where we are actually running 32 bulk inserts. And we should see, requests show that, okay, we are bulk inserting data, and we don't have all that bottleneck that we saw with locks, right? And so we look at ingest rate now. The ingest rate is not going to be, the log generation rate is not quite going to be what Columnstore was because that was compressed row groups. So it's going to be significantly higher because it's still a clustered index. We have not applied compression necessarily. So your ingest rate is much more. It's closer to a heap. But the advantage of this is I'm not going to have to build the index after my initial ingest into the heap, right? So it is, and clustered index is still great for workloads that require singleton lookups and require more of the row format than analytical workloads. So the choice depends on the workload. You see ingest rate is close to the cap, and this will finish also in a couple minutes. Of course, this had a little additional time to sort that data on the client, but if we didn't do that, then we would hit all the lock contention that we did. So we'll come back to this. You'll see this in a little bit, but I will flip to kind of the results pane of these and a few other iterations. And hopefully this will kind of showcase some differences, if you will, of things that I've demoed and some things that I've not. So here I have source data of 60 million rows, roughly 6.5 gigs of data. And in my test, actually, it was 16 parallel streams. Now it's 32 parallel streams. So these results are a little skewed from that perspective. I didn't realize I spun up a larger Spark cluster. But this should give you relative differences for sure, right? A couple of things you'll realize: there's an increased CPU when you compress because compression takes some CPU, and there's a reduction in log generation rate when compressing. And then when loading, we had talked about, so you have the heap. Heap is the fastest if you look at by duration. Everything else is slower than the heap. But what you have to consider when you are loading into a heap is the indexes you will create post load actually matter because the time has to be accounted for because data is not ready for your application until you create those indexes. So you see that heap is capping out almost at the max and hits throttling from a log limit perspective. It's the fastest, has about the lowest CPU, right? And the second set of rows we look at is column store related loading. And one was with that batch size of 1 million, and one was with the batch size of less than that 102,400, which lands up in Delta Store, which is not compressed. If you look at this row, the log generation rate is almost close to the heap because it's not loading in compressed row groups. If you look at the one with compression directly, it's just 22 Mbps versus 94 Mbps. But the CPU trade-off is higher because it's ingesting in compressed row groups. But the delta is not significantly more really. And the data is ready to use. You don't, you know, for analytics, the column store index is created. And then the last one, but not the least, is clustered index, where we have two things to consider here. One is with this sorted input and not. If you don't sort the input, all threads will block, and the time is by far the largest, right? So you have lock contention. CPU is very low because everyone's blocked. But the time is, this is not really a practical, you know, scenario. So if you're using a clustered index, then sort the data on the client. And then you have a couple variations of compression with no compression, row and page compression. But you see there's a slight difference in log generation rate and the size of data as it lands, because then your querying will become less I/O intensive. But there's a trade-off in CPU, right? So I hope this gives you a good view of kind of different table types and the batch sizes and, you know, the trade-off between additional CPU for saving in log generation rate. And you can make some decisions based on your workload and scenarios on, you know, what type of index, batch size, and trade-offs you can make.
Yeah, awesome. I mean, you've shared so many great tips with us. Just thank you so much for coming on the show. I have one question, not to put you on the spot, but what's kind of a mistake that you see a lot of customers make in this space that you wish that you could just kind of share with everyone,
sure,
if there is one?
Yeah, there are several actually, right? So partitioning is probably our least used or a very underused feature for large billion row tables. And partitioning has some complexity in terms of having to maintain partitions, but the benefits outweigh the complexity. You know, talk about several billion row tables. You know, partitioning enables you to rebuild at a partition level and do a bunch of maintenance at a partition level, enable things like incremental statistics. That's one thing which is way underused. And the second, probably most common thing is, like I said, you know, folks who ingest large amounts into heap and then create a clustered index, you know, and don't account for that index creation time in loads, right? So those are probably two. If I see the third one is the column row batch size, you know, thing, and the underuse of compression in general. Compression does help in many cases.
Awesome, cool. So you've actually covered a lot of those things in this video, so that's good. We're getting it out there, and hopefully this is going to help a lot of folks load their data in a more efficient way so that they can get to using it. So again, thanks so much, Denzil, for coming on the show. To our viewers, thanks for watching. Give us a like, leave us a comment, and let us know how you're loading data into Azure SQL, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.
Thank you, Anna.